I'm going to talk to you about model building cosmic inflation and dark energy. Well, the history of the universe requires special initial conditions, which are arranged by cosmic inflation. So what is cosmic inflation? In a nutshell, it's a period of accelerated expansion, a superluminal expansion of space in the early universe. And what it does, it produces a universe which is large and uniform according to observations. Now, in fundamental physics, inflation is usually modeled through the so-called inflationary paradigm, which says that the universe inflates when dominated by the potential energy density of a scalar field called the inflaton field. All right, the equation of motion of a homogeneous scalar field is given in an expanding universe, is of this form here, where phi is the field, the dots are time derivatives, and the prime is a derivative with respect to the field. The form of this form is identical with the equation of motion of a body sliding down a potential under the effect of friction, which is quantified by this parameter H, which is the rate of the universe expansion in our case, the Hubble parameter. So to help our intuition, it's useful to actually consider the inflaton as a ball rolling down a potential because it has the same equation of motion under, of course, the influence of Hubble friction. So the inflationary paradigm says that we need the potential energy domination. And this means that the inflaton field must slow roll down some sort of potential plateau. So there should be a flat region in the potential. But of course, this cannot continue indefinitely. At some point, inflation needs to end when the potential becomes steep and curved. So there is a critical value beyond of which the inflaton actually, the energy density of the inflaton is not potentially dominated anymore. And the inflaton begins to oscillate around its vacuum expectation value, its VEV. And these coherent oscillations correspond to have a particle interpretation, so they are inflaton particles, which can decay into the standard model particles of the thermal bath of the early universe. So that's the picture, the general picture of the inflationary paradigm. But there is one aspect that I would like to emphasize. It has to do with the perturbations of the density that are needed in order to form the galaxies, all right? Because inflation can generate them, generates them too, generates the primordial density perturbation. How does it do that? Well, the superluminal expansion of space during inflation amplifies the quantum fluctuations of the inflaton field and renders them into classical perturbations through the magic of quantum decoherence. And this means that inflation continues a little bit more in some locations than in others. And this creates the primordial density perturbations. To explain this, I reproduce the graph that you just saw, but I am adding also a third dimension, which corresponds to space, X. So the inflaton has perturbations, therefore it doesn't have exactly the same value throughout space. And that's important when actually we are approaching the end of inflation, this critical value that terminates inflation, because there will be some locations where the inflaton has already passed this critical value and therefore inflation has ended. But in other locations, the inflaton is still on the inflationary plateau. So inflation continues. So this means that if there are perturbations in the inflaton, in the value of the inflaton field, this means that there are some locations that inflate more than others. And this gives rise to the primordial density perturbations. Now, do we have any proof of this amazing scenario that quantum fluctuations eventually become galaxies? Indeed we do, because these primordial density perturbations, they reflect themselves onto the cosmic microwave background radiation. And in fact, they cause temperature perturbations through the Sachs-Wolfe effect. They are very small, 10 parts in a million, but they are observable. And this is a picture of the latest observations. The slightly hotter regions are shown in red and the colder regions are shown in blue. If you analyze this signal in spherical harmonics, this is what you get. So these red dots are basically the beam data. And this green line is not the line that goes through the dots, but it's the predictions of cosmic inflations. So you can see that there is spectacular agreement with observations. And in fact, in particular, observations suggest three main things, main characteristics for the primordial density perturbations. First of all, they suggest that they are predominantly adiabatic, and this means that they are the product of a single degree of freedom, the inflaton field. They are also predominantly Gaussian, which reflects the randomness of the original quantum fluctuations. And finally, they are almost scale invariant. What does this mean? Well, approximate scale invariance means that inflation is of a particular type called quasi-de Sitter inflation, in which the density during inflation, the density of the universe, is roughly constant. And in the context of the inflationary paradigm, where the scalar field is responsible for inflation, we can actually, this suggests that the barotropic parameter of the scalar field is the following. The barotropic parameter is of a substance is the ratio of its pressure over its density. For a homogeneous scalar field, this is given by this ratio, the difference between the kinetic energy density minus the potential energy density over their sum. And because the inflaton paradigm suggests that we have potential energy domination during inflation, this means that the second term here is the dominant one, which means that the barotropic parameter is close to minus one. Okay, now we put a lot of emphasis on the perturbations because they can discriminate between inflationary models. All the other fine tunings, which I mentioned in the beginning of my talk, that fine tunings of the Big Bang history that are solved or overcome by inflation are overcome by all models of inflation equally. That's not true about the characteristics of perturbations. They can actually be different between inflationary models. So we are, in particular, we are looking for two quantities, the spectral index and the tensor to scalar ratio. The spectral index has to do with the spectrum of the density perturbations, or equivalently of the curvature perturbation, because the curvature perturbation and the density perturbation are directly linked through the Einstein equations. So you see that if this spectrum of the curvature perturbation is actually written as such, as a power law in terms of K, where K is the momentum scale, then the spectral index appears on the exponent here. But of course, because the spectrum is not an exactly power law, this spectral index is also K-dependent. Now you see that if this spectral index were equal to one, then the exponent would be zero and the scale dependence will be gone, all right? So the spectrum would have been exactly scale invariant, where the observation suggests that we are very close to one. So that's why we have approximate scale invariance. But we are also significantly away from one, which is something that also inflation predicts, because it has to do with the fact that inflation ends at some point, and this end is being felt. So it's not exactly scale invariant. Now, with respect to the tensor to scalar ratio, this is defined as such. It's the ratio between the spectrum of the tensor perturbations over the spectrum of the scalar perturbations. The tensor perturbations are gravitational waves, and they are generated in the same way that the inflaton perturbations are generated. So what do the observations suggest? That these are the latest data. This is a plot, a famous plot of the spectral index with respect to the tensor to scalar ratio with respect to the spectral index. As you can see, we are away, significantly away from exact scale invariance. So this, the spectral index is not one, is less, the tensor contribution can be negligible, all right? So there is an upper bound of about 5% and then less, or 6% and less than that, but it can be actually negligible down to zero. These blobs in this graph correspond to particular inflationary models, and we will go through some of them now, okay? So let's start with quartic Hilton inflation. Quartic Hilton inflation is this one, all right? It's the green band here, okay? As you see, it overlaps very nicely with the preferred parameter space. So the model is this one. It's introduced by Bubukur and Leith in 2005. This lambda, the negative self-coupling, we will say how much it needs to be. That's the form of this potential. So you can see that this is the inflationary plateau, the top of the hill. That's why it's called hilltop. Now, in order to have the correct amplitude of the density perturbations, the so-called Kobe constraint, all right, this lambda needs to be 10 to the minus 12. And then recently, I have actually shown that there is an analytic relation between the inflationary observables, R and the spectral index NS, which is given by this expression, where big N is the number of exponential expansions, EFOLs, of remaining inflation that corresponds to the cosmological scales. All right. This is usually 60, but it can be actually reduced down to 50 if the reheating process that I mentioned before is inefficient. So 60 here corresponds to the big blobs, all right, whereas 50 corresponds to the small blobs. So for every model, you are supposed to actually lie on this line, okay, depending on the details of reheating. Okay. So this model works fine, as we said. The problem is that this lambda is very small and results into a super Planckian VEV for the inflaton field, which means that the perturbative origin of this model, oh, come on, of this model is actually questionable, okay? The next model I would like to talk about is Starobinsky inflation. The Lagrangian is of this form. It was actually introduced by Alexei Starobinsky in 1980, which was, and it's the first inflationary model suggested. And in fact, it was so early that the name inflation has not been coined yet. Okay, as you see here, this is a modified gravity theory, all right? Because we have the Einstein-Hilbert action here. R is the Ricci scalar, all right? And we have a quadratic term here whose strength is parameterized by this constant beta. This is not a Taylor expansion, so this beta can be actually larger than one. And in fact, it has to be much larger. So that's the so-called Jordan frame, the modified gravity frame. Now this quadratic term introduces an additional degree of freedom, which is called the Scalaron field. And we can flesh this out if we switch from the Jordan frame to the Einstein frame, which is the frame where gravity is described by the usual general relativity. We do that through a conformal transformation. So it's a transformation of the metric. And this one fleshes out the Scalaron field, okay? And for this particular theory, the conformal transformation is this, and you end up with a, now this is now in terms of the new metric, with a canonical normalized scalar field in Einstein gravity, all right? Where V here is the potential of this scalar field, which turns out to be of this form here. As you can see, there is this term squared in the squared brackets here, and then this priest factor, 1 over 16 beta, which we will see again. So this is the potential. The form of the potential is this. So you see the inflationary plateau. And the model has these predictions for the spectral index and the tensor to scalar ratio. And they are actually in excellent agreement with observations. So these are the predictions, as you can see. When n is equal to 60, we are actually at the sweet spot of the Planck satellite observations. All right, but even down to 50, we are still well within the one sigma contour. Okay, so in order to have the correct amplitude of perturbations, the Kobe constraint, we need to have a beta huge, more than 10 to the 8. Okay, a similar model is Higgs inflation, introduced by Bezrukhov and Sapochnikov in 2008. Now, the Lagrangian is of this form here. So you can see that again, we have a modified gravity theory. We have the Einstein-Hilbert term here. We have a direct coupling between the scalar field, which I now call H, all right, with the Ricci scalar, okay? There is a direct coupling through this coupling constant Xi, all right? This direct coupling is beyond the minimal coupling that all the fields have with gravity. So it's called a non-minimal coupling. Okay, and it's supposed to be natural for every scalar field. In it is introduced by renormalization in curved space-time. All right. So if since this is true for every scalar field, we can choose the scalar field to be the electroweak Higgs field, which was observed in CERN almost 10 years ago. All right, so we know that this field exists. So if we do that, then this potential is the electroweak Higgs potential, where V is the wave of the electroweak Higgs and the lambda is its self-coupling. All right, so if we move from the Jordan frame to the Einstein frame, we have to do the conformal transformation, and that's the potential that we get. All right, notice that the term in the squared brackets is actually identical with the Starobinsky model. And indeed, the form of the potential is the same. We have the inflationary plateau here. The prefactor is this, okay? The predictions of the model are the same, all right? With respect to the spectral index and the tensor to scalar ratio are the same with the Starobinsky inflation. And in order to have the correct amplitude for the density perturbations, the copy constraint, we have to have psi huge, as we had beta before, all right? There is one difference with Starobinsky inflation, however. It has to do with the fact that this time we are talking about the electroweak Higgs field, okay? And the branching ratios of the Higgs field to standard model particles is actually known. So the reheating process is fully determined, which means that on this line, this is the Starobinsky line, all right? We know exactly where we are. Okay, and indeed, I think that in Higgs inflation, the number of EFOLs is 57 or so, so somewhere here, okay? In contrast, in Starobinsky inflation, the decays of the Scalaron field to the standard model particles are not known, so there is a difference there. And finally, one other possibility I would like to discuss is the alpha attractors introduced by Kalos and Linde and Roest, in supergravity and conformal field theory. The model is, the Lagrangian is of this form here, okay? So this is Einstein gravity now, but the field is non-canonical normalized. You see that the kinetic term is non-canonical, it features poles. Okay, so yes, parameterized by this alpha here, hence the alpha attractors, all right? So if we want to switch to the canonical field, so from this curly phi into the actual phi, then we just have to do this transformation. And then we actually render the theory into Einstein gravity with a canonically normalized scalar field. And we have this transformation between the two fields, which is resulting by this expression here. So this is the canonical field, this is the non-canonical. Okay, the interesting thing about this proposal is that the observables, the inflationary observables, the spectral index and the tensor to scalar ratio are always the same regardless of the form of the scalar potential. In fact, the tensor to scalar, the spectral index is identical to the case of Starobinsky inflation and Higgs inflation. The tensor to scalar ratio is also identical provided alpha is one. But alpha can be bigger or smaller than one. So basically in this plot here, we go up and down because the spectral index is independent of alpha. So we start from here when alpha is one, but we can go up for big alpha or down. This is the R, this is the tensor to scalar ratio, all right? So you can see that these yellow lines correspond to the alpha attractors. Right? Obviously we cannot go very large because we are exiting the observational contours. So in fact, the observation suggests that alpha needs to be at most about 18 or so. Now, as I said, all these predictions are independent of the form of the scalar potential. That's why these models are called alpha attractors. A prominent example, however, of alpha attractors considers a quadratic scalar potential in terms of the non-canonical inflaton. When you actually use this transformation between canonical and non-canonical fields, the potential takes this form here, which you can plot and it looks like this. It looks like a giant T, and that's why the model is called T-model inflation. All right, so enough about inflation. Let's talk about dark energy now. Now, observations suggest that the late universe is also undergoing accelerated expansion as we had in the early universe. This time attributed to an exotic substance called dark energy. which makes up almost 70% of the universe content at present. Now, this dark energy could correspond to a positive value of the cosmological constant, but this would require an incredible fine-tuning of the order of 10 to the minus 120, which has been called the worst fine-tuning in physics. It also violates the so-called Swampland conjectures, which suggest that there are no de Sitter vacua with a completion in the ultraviolet. Okay, this is why many other alternative proposals have been put forward to explain the dark energy observations. And one prominent one is quintessence, which is called quintessence because it's the fifth element after baryonic matter, dark matter, photons, the CMB mainly, and neutrinos. All right. So what is quintessence? It's a scalar field like the inflaton field, typically slowly rolling down a runaway potential. So that's the potential here. It has this form, it's a runaway form, which is called the quintessential tail. And the field is this, this blob rolling down, okay? Now, therefore, dark energy today is really a late inflationary period, says this proposal. And this late inflation is quasi de Sitter as well. Why? Because the observation suggests that the barotropic parameter of dark energy is also close to minus one, okay? Now, typically the field is initially frozen and unfreezes today to become when it becomes dominant. And this type of quintessence is called thawing quintessence. But the initial frozen value of that field must be such that the corresponding potential density, energy density, is comparable to the density of the universe. And this requirement is a very tough requirement to meet. It's called the coincidence requirement. And how can we explain coincidence? Well, one way of doing so is quintessential inflation. What is quintessential inflation? It's the identification of the quintessence field with the inflaton field. And it was put forward originally by Peebles and Bielenki at the end of the previous century. It has a lot of merits. First of all, it's a natural idea because both quintessence and the inflaton field are scalar fields. Secondly, it's an economic proposal because one only needs one degree of freedom, the inflaton field, to explain the two periods of acceleration in the early and the late universe. Also, you can treat these periods of acceleration in a common theoretical framework. Of course, a successful model of quintessential inflation has to satisfy the observations of both cosmic inflation and dark energy, which is a very difficult task, but not impossible. And finally, the quintessence initial conditions, the coincidence requirement, are actually fixed by the inflationary attractor. So this is what motivated us in the first place. The potential is of this form. So it's typically of this form. So it features the inflationary plateau and the quintessential tail, okay? So the inflaton field doesn't oscillate and decay after the end of inflation, after it falls from the inflationary plateau, but it needs to survive until the present to become quintessence. So the reheating of the universe has to occur without the decay of the inflaton field. There are numerous mechanisms that do so, but I don't think I have the time to actually go through them. Maybe Javier Rubio will. Okay, let's see how examples of how to model quintessential inflation. Let's one proposal was with a student of mine several years ago in the context of alpha attractors that I mentioned before. So that's the Lagrangian. The kinetic term is the same that we have seen before, but instead of a quadratic potential, like in T-model inflation, we actually introduced an exponential potential with the strength of the exponent characterized by this kappa constant here, okay? And we also, so that's the non-canonical field, of course, we also introduced a negative cosmological constant because we wanted to have zero vacuum density. Now, a negative cosmological constant has no problem with the Swampland conjectures. Indeed, string theory welcomes de Sitter vacua. So you can switch to the canonical field and render the potential in terms of the canonical field in this form, all right? It's not obvious that that this is so. This little n is actually a combination of kappa, the strength of the exponent in the exponential, and alpha of the alpha attractors. Now, it's not obvious from this form that it is actually successful quintessential inflation, but if you plot it, it looks like this. So it features the inflation plateau and the quintessential tail. So we have inflation in the limit of very small, very negative values of the inflaton, in which in this limit, the potential becomes this. And this bracket is identical with the Starobinsky bracket. So it has very nice predictions. And in the opposite limit, for very large values of the inflaton, we have quintessence. And this potential reduces to this form, which is the standard exponential quintessential tail. We have shown in that paper that the model works with alpha about 0.3 and kappa about 60 or so. So basically, the mass scale suppressing the inflaton here is more like the gut scale, not the Planck scale. So that's one example. Another possibility is trying to model quintessential inflation in Palatine gravity. In a recent paper of mine with my student, we actually proposed this theory. So notice here that you have the first two terms are the Starobinsky model. However, we are in Palatine gravity, and in Palatine gravity, there is no scalar. All right. So the quadratic term does not introduce an extra degree of freedom, which means that we have to introduce our scalar field explicitly by hand here. So that's the Jordan frame, obviously, of modified gravity. We do the conformal transformation and we switch to the Einstein frame, and the Lagrangian now becomes this. Well, R here is, of course, in terms of the new metric. The most interesting thing here is the form of the potential. Because you see, for very large values of V, then this one in the denominator is negligible. So V crosses out, and basically the potential approaches a constant. 16 beta, remember, it's the Starobinsky plateau. All right, so it's the inflationary plateau. In the opposite limit, before we get there, we actually showed that inflation can be successful for beta more than 10 to the 7, which is a little bit smaller than what Starobinsky inflation requires. In the opposite limit, when V is small, then this term is negligible. And this is also true for the kinetic term. So the kinetic term becomes canonical. So if the field becomes canonical, it has the behavior of the canonical scalar field, which means that we only need a runaway potential to have Thoning quintessence that can also work for very high scale, for high energy scales. Why? Because it approaches the inflationary plateau. So the potential U would look like this. All right. So for low values of V is actually identical with a non-canonical case, but for very large values of Vs, we have the potential departs from that form and approaches a constant. Okay, so we have something like hilltop inflation here. So this was the idea. And what we did in that paper is we considered a generalization of the original Peebles and Vilenkin quintessential inflation model. So this, okay, where N and Q here are integers and lambda is just a constant. And we found that the best choices for N and Q are 2 and 4, in which case the theory is written like this, all right? Where lambda now is incorporated with inside this big M, this, sorry, small m, okay? So that's how the potential looks, the blue line. And U, the potential of the canonical normalized field, is actually looks like this. So you see that the Palatini setup flattens the potential, reaches the inflationary plateau here as required. Now, in order to have to satisfy the copy constraint and have the correct amplitude of perturbations, we need that this M is actually 10 to the 13 GeV. And these are the predictions that we have for the spectral index and tensor to scalar ratio. As you see, we are actually inside the one sigma contour. The bigger beta is, the closer we are to negligible tensors here, okay? But we can have very large tensors, up to 5% or so, for beta about 10 to the 8, okay? So that's what we find, very nice. What about quintessence? Well, the coincidence requirement is resolved if big M is of order of 10 GeV. So you see, no incredible fine-tuning is required. Now, the interesting thing is that for thawing quintessence, of course, the barotropic parameter of the unfreezing quintessence is variable. And here is the plot of the barotropic parameter with respect to the universe expansion, parameterized by the scale factor A here. So the scale factor grows with the expansion. So this vertical line is denoting the present time. And the blue line here is actually the barotropic parameter of quintessence. So original quintessence is frozen, has zero kinetic energy, and therefore it has barotropic parameter equal to minus one. But when it starts becoming dominant, it unfreezes, the kinetic energy density increases, and therefore the barotropic parameter increases from minus one. These two horizontal lines correspond to the observational bounds. All right, so you see that we are within. Now this orange line here is the barotropic parameter of the universe itself, of the universe total. So early on, of course, it was very close to zero because the universe was matter dominated in the recent past, and matter is pressureless, which means that it has zero barotropic parameter. But once the quintessence becomes important, the barotropic parameter of the universe decreases, and today it needs to fall inside these lines, which are the observational constraints. In the future, you see that these two lines merge. And this is, of course, natural because the quintessence will become, today it's 70% of the universe content, it will become 100% of the universe content, in which case the barotropic parameter of the universe is the barotropic parameter of quintessence. So the important thing is that the barotropic parameter of dark energy is variable. And this is actually parameterized through the so-called CPL parametrization shown here. So this is a function of the scale factor, and these W and WA are constants. Okay, so this is a Taylor expansion. So this is the constant contribution, and this is related to the rate of change of the barotropic parameter with respect to A. Now, the Planck satellite observations suggest that the constant contribution here is between minus one and minus 0.95. And the values for WA, for the running of the barotropic parameter, are these. So when we actually put these values, this range for the constant barotropic parameter to our model, what we find is that the running of the barotropic parameter is actually within this much narrower region compared to observation. So it really works very nice. One other possibility of modeling quintessential inflation in Palatine gravity is the following. It's something that is work in progress. That's why I have 2021 in brackets, but we are about to actually start writing it up with my student and some other collaborators. So that's the Lagrangian density now. We have the Starobinsky term. We also have a non-minimal term, all right? This time the potential is actually an exponential, like we had the quintessential inflation with alpha attractors, if you remember. All right? We do the conformal transformation and we arrive to the usual canonical normalized scalar field with Einstein gravity, where now this U potential is actually given by this expression here, where curly phi is actually given in terms of the canonical phi, and they are related through this expression here, all right? So you see that there are two extremes. One extreme is when this term dominates the term in the square brackets here, in which case the square brackets are negligible, V cancels out, and we are actually approaching a constant. So this corresponds to the inflationary plateau. That's the Starobinsky result. In the opposite limit, this term is negligible, and the same is true in the denominator here. And this means that the canonical and non-canonical fields are actually the same. All right, so the field is really becomes canonical normalized and actually can work as a thawing quintessence. And in this case, if you disregard this, at some point this will become the dominant in the denominator. So the potential looks like that, okay? So such a potential leads to temporary acceleration, and which actually has an, a, a, an additional advantage because it overcomes the problem of future horizons in Lambda CDM, but I don't have the time to actually go into detail for this one. So to conclude, let's talk about Kination a little bit, okay? So first of all, we said about inflation and quintessence. What happens in this region here? Well, what happens is that after inflation, the kinetic energy density of the field dominates, all right? When the field actually drops from the potential cliff here, it is in free fall, all right? So it's dominated by the kinetic energy. And therefore the Klein-Gordon equation of motion actually becomes this. So it's potential independent, and therefore it's model independent, okay? Now, what happens is that the field rolls very quickly down to the quintessential tail, okay? And then it freezes. Why? Okay, let's see. First of all, the kinetic density of the field, when it is actually, if you solve this equation, you immediately find that it actually drops as 8^-6, all right? Now, some mechanism creates radiation. In order to have reheating, you have to have that, all right? Radiation density goes as 8^-4, which means that it actually is diluted less efficiently with the expansion. And therefore there is a moment where it takes over. This is the moment of reheating, okay? From then onwards, the usual hot Big Bang story takes place. What happens to the scalar field? It continues to roll for a little while and then it freezes at some point, okay? So it freezes with some residual potential density. It remains frozen for a long time until the present when it starts to take over again, okay? So the value of the frozen field is determined largely by the what we call the reheating efficiency. That's the density parameter for radiation at the end of inflation. So how much radiation you have. You see that if the reheating efficiency is small, then because of this minus here, the displacement of the field, how much it rolls during kination, is actually large, all right? So a large roll corresponds to small reheating efficiency. All right, the most important consequence of kination, so this period is called kination, this period that I just mentioned. We have the radiation and matter eras of the hot Big Bang. We have inflation, where the density is constant. This period where the density of the universe is dominated by the kinetic density of the scalar field is called kination. Okay, the most important consequence of kination is that it generates a spike in the gravitational waves. Well, we have said already that inflation generates primordial gravitational waves, all right? And usually what you hear is that it generates a scale invariant spectrum of primordial tensor perturbations. That's so, that corresponds to the modes that re-enter the horizon in the radiation era, because the density of gravitational waves and the density of radiation, they both scale as 8^-4, and therefore the ratio is constant. However, during kination, that's no more so. Why? Because the density of kination scales as 8^-6. So instead of being scale invariant, the spectrum of the gravitational waves during kination is a spike, all right? And in fact, as we said, reheating efficiency determines how long inflation kination lasts, and the longer the kination is, the bigger the spike, all right? And because the most inefficient reheating leads to the longest kination possible, this actually leads to the larger spike possible, which actually is so large that it challenges the predictions of the Big Bang nucleosynthesis process, which is the sacred cow of cosmology. So we can actually quantify all this through the so-called spectral density parameter of gravitational waves, which is the density parameter per logarithmic interval wavelength, log of wavelength, all right? So these are the three areas, okay? The matter-dominated period corresponds to this here. That's also true for conventional inflation, okay? For the radiation-dominated period, we said that this ratio is constant, all right? So it's constant, okay? This is the scale invariant spectrum that people expect from inflation. But during kination, we have a period where it's actually growing, okay? And the longer kination lasts, so if it lasts only that long, then the spike is that big. But if it lasts very long, the spike is very big. And in fact, it challenges PBN constraints. Okay? And finally, we are the conclusions. Cosmic inflation determines the initial conditions of the history of the universe and leads to a large and uniform universe. It also generates the primordial density perturbations, which seed the formation of galaxies and are reflected on the primordial cosmic microwave background anisotropy. The universe today engages into a late inflationary period, which may be due to quintessence, which is a form of dark energy. Quintessential inflation employs a common theoretical framework for the early and late universe, leads to a varying dark energy barotropic parameter and a surge in the generation of the primordial gravitational waves. Palatini gravity in particular is a natural framework for model building quintessential inflation. Why? Because it flattens a runaway potential to generate the inflationary plateau. Now, obviously, predictions of successful Palatini quintessential inflation may be soon tested by observations. And that's it. Thank you very much. And if you are interested more about inflation and dark energy, you can also read my book here.